attention now because Tina Kirsi is in Tartu, real Tartu in Estonia. But she will, but she will give a presentation titled "The Temporary University Beyond the Composite Family Memory of the Baltic University." Because as you already know, his father was involved in Baltic University. So, welcome, Tina, to Toronto.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Thank you. Shall I begin?
Yes. Yes, please.
Okay. I begin with a blanket. A blanket, the color of which was a dark olive green. And it was a blanket that my father, in his very healthful custom of letting the bread settle into the bones, leipä luuseraspa, in the afternoons, used to wind himself into and cover himself then with another blanket. A 20-minute nap was enough to keep him chipper for the rest of the day. Embroidered into the corner of this blanket were his initials, and the blanket had been carefully hemmed so that it would not unravel. It was a British Army blanket that was the only covering for DPs who had been issued whatever they owned from the help organizations, from UNRWA or from the British Army. And this blanket, as I found out, was the basis or the element in another encounter that my father had in the fall of 1946, when there was a very light knock at the door where he and seven or eight other professors had sleeping quarters at the Deutsche Ring in Hamburg. And the person who knocked delicately was Lauri Weiska, who has written about his memoirs of how he became a chemist. And when he knocked on my father's door, he had already eliminated several possible specializations, including the law, which he found very boring, and a couple of other specializations that he didn't think he had the patience for. And so he wanted to enroll in the chemistry department, the chemistry faculty to be exact. And my father was at that time the dean of that faculty. So as Lauri Weiska writes the episode, there was a knock at the door. He had a small application form, and my father sat up on the bunk bed, the higher bunk bed by the door. And as Lauri Weiska writes, he had just awoken from a nap, but he was too polite to show it, wound up in his army blanket. He jumped down, and they went to the table by the window, took the soup pot that was sitting there and laid it aside, and my father gave his signature for Lauri Weiska to bring his career as a chemist to a beginning. There are many people from the chemistry department and from the other faculties of the Baltic University who were very successful in their later careers, in their onward journey to resettlement in Australia, in the United States, and in Canada, and also in Sweden. And this story is woven into a remarkable book that I'm sure that most of you know, or at least have paged your way through. And this is the book put together by Elmar Jarveso, called Baltiligol. And I say very adamantly that it is only the Estonian experience of the Baltic University that this book contains. It would be a very interesting project, but I'm afraid a little too complicated at this time because so many memories have been lost and people have disappeared and passed on, to compare and discuss the experiences of the majority of students in the Baltic University who were Latvians, and then the Estonians and the Lithuanians. And unfortunately, I'm not there at the conference to begin conversations with a few of the representatives from these other groups. But the book, Baltic University, Baltiligol, filled our modest basement in the fall, late summer of 1997. My father was, as very often in an organizing role, he was not a totally leadership-oriented person, and he was packaging books to send to the people who had ordered these books that contained their memoirs and the story of the Baltic University, and of course a great deal of photographic material. And there are other traces in my family history of the Baltic University, because In my family, there was one student at the Baltic University and one faculty member slash dean. And so, looking through the book later on, of course I looked in the index for the pictures of both of my parents, and thought back over what I had done in 1988 when I was an exchange lecturer at the University of Mainz in Germany, and decided to conclude my time in Germany with a trip to trace down my parents' tracks in the Baltic University. And so in June of 1988, I took a trip to Hamburg, and with the directions that my father had written to me in a letter, I found Holzentor 1. I went to Pinneberg. I looked for the familiar but now, of course, overbuilt area where the Zoolager was, the dormitory nearest to the operation facilities of the Baltic University. Went to Pinneberg, which was its later site, but the most interesting surprise was the Deutsche Ring. I had heard stories of this building, and it was actually quite unfathomable to me that in 1988 it was still an insurance company. It was still doing what it always had been doing. But in the early days of Baltic University, the Deutsche Ring was a kind of transition facility, and in fact many people feared that if they entered this building they would be forcibly repatriated, because those who were being sent back to the Baltic lands were given luxury treatment, including a salsa band that they got to enjoy and dance during their last days in Germany prior to embarkation for Estonia, Latvia, or Lithuania. But the stigma of the Deutsche Ring wore off, and in the summer days of 1945, the housing for professors and some students of the Baltic University was in the Deutsche Ring. This is where Lauri Vaska found my father. And I have heard many stories in my family about the legendary Christmas of 1945, which was celebrated in the Deutsche Ring with pomp and circumstance and with a fair amount of imbibables. And this was a happy Christmas for people. They had then been away from their homeland for a year and 3 months, and now the war was over, although the uncertainty was in the air of what would really happen to the Baltic homelands. So having said this much, I have learned in my scholarly life to be very distrustful of memories. In fact, to build a barrier between myself and memories, particularly memories of other people, that, of course, I, as the hearer of them, pick up selectively and unevenly, and, God forbid, pass on an even more altered form to the next round of listeners, such as my kids, who look at the pictures in the Baltic University book and ask a lot of questions. So I've learned to immunize myself against memories, to not use them as a reliable source. And perhaps I'm going a bit too far here, but I don't want to just in this talk about parents' memories and the fact that the Baltic University is woven into my family traditions. Therefore, let me turn now to the notion of the temporary university. And my observations are based on reading of the Baltirikod book, as well as my own experience as a university teacher, which is now so long that I don't want to tell you how long it is. So 3.5 years, which is the time that the university, the Baltic University, existed, in current, present-day Europe, is actually too much of an undergraduate education. Because in 3 years, one should have a bachelor's degree, and one should be ready to be employable. In the North American system, where one of my children has already had the good fortune of graduating, 4 years is still considered to be the maturation period for a student to learn what they need to learn in an area of specialization, thus to be able to also have the option of graduate study. So if one was a student at the Baltic University, one was there for a maximum of 3.5 years, which is that kind of in-between time. It is important to understand that from the very beginning, attempts were made to access enrollment in German universities for students of Baltic extraction, and these efforts coincided with the Baltic University. It was understood that students who were coming from the Baltics had fluent German, Let us not forget that the Baltic University was a German-speaking university. It was the lingua franca, the scholarly lingua franca of those who taught and those who listened. So there was an effort from the very beginning, as soon as the German universities began to function again, to get an allotment of students into the Universität Hamburg, the Hansa Universität Hamburg. And the figures, I won't go into them at this point, but they're interesting to analyze, that the greatest number of applicants for these positions were Estonians, but only a third of those who were accepted actually attended the Hamburg University. So these were kind of tandem efforts. The building of the Baltic University, finding a site for it. Every university depends on infrastructure. And once again, from my perspective as a university teacher, I see how much bureaucracy nowadays goes into the maintenance of the infrastructure of the university, the grounds, the facilities, the records, the tourist attractions, and all of the rest of it that goes together. Aside from the tourist attractions, the Baltic University, because it answered to the Education Control Commission of the British government, the occupation forces, had to produce a credible infrastructure with respect to the students. It had to provide housing for students, and these were usually primitive barracks. In the Zoolage, I heard many, many stories about this as a child. So there was a campus, and there was also a dining hall. Regrettably, with 1,200 calories a day of allotment, and that was probably every day a different variety of gemüse. So the student body was maintained in a separate facility, and then the professors had slightly better accommodations, but not really much more to speak of. Record keeping and keeping track of enrollment, which is a task of any university, was particularly difficult in the Baltic University because many people became refugees and many of their documents were lost. So usually in the presence of witnesses, the secretariat of the Baltic University listened to the argument that someone had graduated from high school, on what date and where, and then whether they had pursued any higher education after that prior to becoming refugees. And on the basis of this, study books were issued. And we still have one of them in our family archives. Among the people who worked in this record-keeping area were Ilse Lehistan, who later became a very prominent linguistic scholar at the Ohio State University, but she was one of the people who helped in the process of matriculating students and record-keeping. And then there was the Marta Tal, who was my mother's friend and roommate in her early years in New York, and who also had a no-nonsense expression about her. You can find her easily in the index to Baltic Boy. Another important facet then, given the record-keeping function, was maintaining good relations with the British armed forces, with the occupation forces, giving accountability to what was happening in the classroom. But lest we go too far on those supportive functions of a university, there was an active student body, an active student representation in an organization formed by each of the student, each of the nations represented. And they concocted everything from bands to public performances of theater to visits to concerts and theaters in Hamburg. So as Elmar Jadwezo summarized it, in this small territory in the center of Hamburg, you couldn't have asked for a better intellectual atmosphere to surround a university. But what is a university? I hope I'm not repeating what other speakers may have said today, and I'm sorry I'm not there to listen. But what is the lifeblood of a university? It is teaching and research, or research and teaching. Imagine yourself in a circumstance where you are a lecturer and all you have on board is what you remember. And you have a blackboard, an old-fashioned one, sometimes green, sometimes black. You have chalk. And with those resources, you need to teach on a strict curriculum so that students who are in some ways in university to pass the time and not let the 5 years of refugeeship turn them into people with a lot of boredom and not much on board, try teaching in those circumstances. It's a really good trial of one's teaching abilities. It was not that there were no books, but that the accumulated expertise and the skill at teaching of the people who had become professors in this institution mattered a great deal more than it might have in a situation where everyone had a textbook and where perhaps there were even printed abstracts or printed notes that were passed around, as was common in European universities. I am curious, and remain curious to this day, about the research that was done at the Baltic University. It is understandable that in the humanities, where one really needs nothing but books, today they're financing the university and saying, oh, you humanities people, you're overstaffed, you're overfunded, all you need is a piece of paper and pen, and you need a bunch of books, and they're owned by the library, so you don't need any of that money. That money is needed for people who want a chemistry lab. Well, this is today. And by the way, there were no PowerPoint slides back then either. But the research conducted in the Baltic University during the time that these people were teaching and learning is actually a topic that deserves more attention, and I hope that someone picks them up. And so I turn now back to the representatives, the only representatives I have of the Baltic University in my own family, and try to fit them onto this mosaic of a temporary university, because it was a university that really didn't last for very long and existed as a kind of funnel, as a kind of transition step for students who didn't want there to be a very long interruption in their education. My father was a member of the Hamburg Estonian Committee, and as was true in other places in Germany, the Estonian committees and the analogues in the Latvian and Lithuanian communities functioned as a center for exchanging information, mainly for people to find each other. Because it so happened that when people went and left in September 1944, all families did not leave together. And so you could have people in separate parts of Germany, very far from each other, not really knowing about each other's survival, let alone getting together and putting themselves under one roof. So the Hamburg Estonian Committee was functioning as this kind of information exchange bureau, and my father was one of the secretaries there. I think probably because he was a modest man and he had very nice handwriting. He listened to people. So when the Baltic University was formed, my father had a master's in chemical engineering, and the faculty senate elected him to be the dean of the chemistry faculty, and in the ensuing 2 years to be the assistant dean of the faculty. This meant a great deal of administrative work, and it also included dealing with a very practical problem. How can you teach chemistry without a laboratory? How can you teach chemistry in a dry lab situation? Along with some friends, and my father was not the chief organizer here, but he was one of them, the Bismarck Oberhochschule was a high school that had received little bombing damage, and so a kind of makeshift chemistry lab was put together in the fall of 1946. However, when the cold season set in, it was just plain too cold to even get the Bunsen burners burning in any kind of consecutive way, so they had to resort to teaching without a laboratory for the winter season. And my father's work included preparation of curriculum, administration of examinations, and most of all, taking what he knew and making it accessible to the students who were listening, and who then had only two things to rely on. One was their own notes, and the other was other people's notes. There was a great deal of comparison of notes then. So my father died before I had a chance to ask him, what was the juncture, what was the conjunction of research and teaching for him while he was at the Baltic University? What I did know was that when the Baltic University moved to Pinneberg, my father had already formed the trail to gain his PhD in Hannover. And so he left the Baltic University about a year and a half after it was founded in order to pursue his own chemistry degree. And among his students by that time were Lauri Vaska, Hilbert Baldson, and Heino Susi, all of them prominent in their own way in the Estonian communities in the U.S. And of them, only Herbert Balsar survives. And he is written also in the Baltic University book. So my father took his research elsewhere while he continued to teach and minister to some extent in the Baltic University. But there's another perspective in the family. My mother, Nelly Guiv Girs, was a student of medicine from the very beginning at the Baltic University. All of her papers had been lost at sea, but she had completed the training program in Tallinn of the midwifery and nursing school, and practiced nursing and particularly midwifery at the Tallinn General Hospital throughout the war. She was valued as a very practical and rational-minded person from others who knew her at that time. She had not pursued medicine in the beginning while she was in Estonia because she had had a very negative experience when her class, her high school class from the Tallinn Girls Commercial High School, was taken on a field trip to Tartu University, and she must have been in grade 10 or 11 at the time, but they were taken straight to the old anatomy building to watch a dissection process. And this was so revolting to my mother that she decided she would never deal with dead people and medicine again. But the midwifery and nursing school was an interesting community in its own right, so she came with skills in medicine, but not necessarily the teaching of the preclinical subjects, let alone the rigorous clinical aspect. So my mother studied chemistry, and she had to take a compulsory course in practical chemistry. And so she sat in the classroom that was taught by a certain Voldemar Pirs. And that was how my future father met my future mother. And my mother did not finish her studies. She transferred at the end of 1947 to Hamburg University, where she pursued her medical studies until it was clear that everyone needed to emigrate. And her friends were leaving one by one for various parts in the world. And she felt very, very alone. And so she decided to emigrate without having finished her studies. The exact amount of time that she had to completion was a family secret that I did not learn until after she had died. But she was one of these students who was practical enough to use the time that she had at her disposal to continue her education. And she was also a leader in the Estonian University Students Association for the first year of its operation. So there were many anecdotes in our family about this place and about the various places that it had been located, including the historical museum in Hamburg, which needed to be revamped and renovated before anyone could use it. And then, of course, Pinneberg. And when I asked some of the soldiers at Pinneberg in 1988 whether they had ever heard of the Flüchtlinge, then a few of them had. And so I told my story in German and walked through the different areas of that garrison at which the Baltic University found perhaps the greatest room, square meter per head that it would ever find. So let us come back to the notion of temporariness and the notion of a makeshift university. From what I have read and heard, it seems to me that there was a great synergy that was managed between three Baltic scholar communities with the common interest in providing an educational milieu that would allow young people who had been uprooted and who were still not sure, as the rector said, that they had not untied Darius's knot. Herodotus had apparently reported that Darius assigned the untangling of several knots to his conquered people, and the knot that the rector wanted the Estonian, Latvian, and Lithuanian students at the Baltic University to untangle was the knot of the future of their homeland. And his speech is also in Estonian in the Baltic University book. But bringing this to a close, I would like to comment on another very contemporary topic, and that is academic success. If one looks in the Estonian book, the Balti Ülikool, one sees that in very many specialties, ranging from very practical fields, medicine, dentistry, chemistry, all the way into the humanities, to theology, linguistics, and literary study, a number of people who spent a few years to 3.5 years at the Baltic University were able to find a launching pad to go on to the further stages of their academic journey. And so the Baltic University is to be thanked for having done this role. But as is true today, in my own motley crew of students, in their pursuit of their baccalaureate degree in European terms, everything isn't quite that sunny. And academic success becomes a relative concept. And so as I think about it, there are many people who passed through the Baltic University and went on and became rather modest figures. They were not prominent in their fields. They were not leaders of laboratories. They didn't teach in the university. They made homes. They taught their children the language that they thought was perishing. They participated in community organizations. And they made a lot of handicrafts for display at ethnic festivals, which was one of the strategies for keeping the ethnic communities tied to a greater public forum. And so to conclude with my deep skepticism, my infiltrated skepticism about memories, these last memories are my own, not my mother's or my father's. My mother taught me about a kind of respect, even a kind of tenderness, for things and projects and pursuits that remain unfinished. I did not understand that when I was as young as she was when she was at Baltic University studying medicine. It's only very gradually that I've come to accept this gift, that there are things one does that never get finished, that don't produce the distinction of outer public recognition, but that somehow fit uncomfortably with the rest of life. So I've learned that from her, and she died in 1980, and because she died, I had the freedom not to finish my medical education. My father, who was on the teaching end of things in the Baltic University, received his PhD in 1949, and because of his PhD, was able to land a very respectable, high-ranking position in a chemical plant in Buffalo, New York. His emigration went without a hitch. But he never taught in university again. He was a research chemist in the field of plastics and the field of paints, and he really enjoyed the work of laboratory chemistry. But what was I privileged to have? When I was in high school, and I had chemistry, and I had organic chemistry, and I had mathematics, and I had physics, then my father was the one to whom I could always turn with questions. And he was the kind of teacher who would seemingly, just from his sleep, drop you about five or six additional difficult problems just to make sure that you had everything clear, the concepts were in place, as well as the formulas. What I remember most about those times when I sat with my father over my homework problems was stoichiometry, the most practical part of chemistry, where everything comes to a head. How much molecular mass and what goes into a reaction. I know now, having reflected and having read by Thudigoid as a collective book, I know that those skills of teaching, at least partly derived from his time in front of the blackboard in the Baltic University. So what I have learned, and these are my memories, no longer my parents, neither of whom is living, my memories are of the kind of importance of unfinished projects and the impact that they have on a later life. And from my father's side of the family, one blanket and the joy of learning and teaching. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. people.